So we are here in Deutsche Welle, you know, discussing the media freedom and the issues faced by journalists around the world, you know, global media freedom, the platform. We have Mr. Salil Shetty, whose session just ended. He's the Secretary General of Amnesty International. And I think there couldn't have been, you know, a more appropriate person to talk about media freedom, because you have the bird eye view of what is, you know, happening in Africa, in Arab world, in, even in Europe, you know, and more crucially in India. What is your view? I mean, you have seen what is happening in Africa. So let's talk about in Africa. Usual suspects are, of course, Zimbabwe and, you know, sort of other countries. How bad the situation on, you know, media freedom is in Africa?
In Africa?
Yeah.
I mean, you, Africa is not one country, right? So each place is very different. And I think, you know, there's a global trend right now. So you can pick individual countries. But the global trend is that we have a lot of, you know, kind of very, very muscular leaders who've come to power, from Philippines to Hungary to, you know, in Rwanda, for example, or Ethiopia. You know, these are leaders who are very dominant and very aggressive in the way they deal with the press. So I would say that in many, many countries across Africa, and I would say, you know, even in Asia, we have a situation where the media is either silenced through forced means, or they're sort of self-censoring themselves. Because, like, India is a very interesting case, right? Because you have the ownership of the media is mostly with the big corporate houses. So that has its own dimension as to how much, you know, independence you have. But more than that, a lot of the people who are running the media themselves, leave alone the pressure from the owners, they themselves, I'm finding, are sort of trying to toe the line, you know, because it has very practical implications. If you don't toe the line, you don't get government advertisements. But, you know, you get personally intimidated. It happens in a very sophisticated way.
Well, we
it's
have,
not crude. So.
We have slightly worse than that situation. I mean, of course, you have been in the line of fire. I mean, Amnesty's and Greenpeace and all. But coming back to the journalists, I mean, like people like us, who have years of working, you know, sort of experience for international media, the BBC and the rest of it, have now suddenly become unemployable. So therefore, we had to launch a platform where we could do fearless journalism, hence Janta Ka Reporter. Now, what is happening now, and I'm sure you'd be aware of, is that if you happen to be remotely critical of the Modi government, which is the case here, you would be labeled as anti-national. So it's almost like Zimbabwe-like scenario. So there you are anti-patriot, unpatriot, now here you are anti-national. And if you have a Muslim name like me, then you are jihadi as well. Now, how do you deal with that situation?
Well, you know, I think that this attack on the media, you know, although despite us being known as a democracy and all open society, etc., attack on the media and, you know, on critical journalists who question the government, first of all, cuts across parties and, I mean, the BJP or Modi, etc. This has always happened. Mm. My father's a journalist, and, you know, he was arrested, taken to Haryana, and because he raised the issue about the Sikh struggle, this I'm talking about 20, 30 years ago. Yeah. So they used the Pota and the Tada and all of that. This is a long, long time ago. And that was very much in the Congress regime. So I don't want to ascribe it only to one government.
True.
But right now, I think we have a more serious problem, which is, so you do have a kind of a RSS-BJP regime, which has a kind of a Hindutva view of the country, and so they have their own definition of what nationalism is. But the more worrying bit is that they have such strong, you know, urban middle class support, or even rural support, if you look at the UP election outcomes.
Also, so, I mean, it's a fake news. I mean, using the social media army,
social media,
you know, sort of spreading the fake news.
That's a very systematic way in which they're doing it. So I would say that the situation is quite worrying. And I mean, if you say what is the solution, I think there is no shortcut to speaking the truth, because it's not a question of saying you're anti-Modi. We want the facts to come out.
Correct.
That's all.
Correct.
So
in this case, it happens to be against him because he's ruling the country.
Who was the government? You know, our job is to, the job of media and Amnesty is to speak truth
Absolutely.
To power. It's to hold governments and leaders to account. And so as long as we are honest and we are true to our profession and we are ethical, nothing should stop us. And, you know, there should be, I mean, there will be consequences. We're already seeing that happening. I mean, they're not even leaving some very powerful houses like NDTV, etc. So the small actors are, but I think we have to press on. You know, that's our job. Governments will come and go, but truth and justice will prevail.
So the organization like yourself or the United Nations, My frustration is that you, when you have this elected leader of a so-called thriving democracy, I call so-called because we are really not truly democratic, when he visits around the world, you know, what could the international agencies like yourself, United Nations, could do to kind of, you know, put him under the pressure that, look, you're doing something which is absolutely not acceptable?
You know, my view generally on this question is that I think our leaders, particularly developing country leaders, should first and foremost be accountable to our own people. Mm. So I'm more in favor of building a movement inside our countries, whether it's India or Pakistan or Bangladesh, to hold our own leaders to account. Because the situation in Bangladesh is also very serious. Pakistan is, you know, Pakistan's been a basket case for a long time, so it's a different story. Because India, you know, this, despite everything else, there's still some hope with the judiciary, there's still some hope with people's movements. You know, we have a strong social movement history. So I think first and foremost, let's hold these people to account inside the country. But internationally, I mean, Amnesty never hesitates from speaking the truth. You know, so I think India is very sophisticated. You know, the way it implements these things, it's always on the edge. Yeah. So you can't really say that you're violating international law, but you know, it's kind of the borderline of.
So now you see the last one. I would just say that you have a public lynching, which has become a part of our society now. On a daily basis, a person will be killed.
Gaurakshak thing.
So-called. From our platform, we refuse to call them Gaurakshak. Okay. We call them right-wing terrorists because that's what essentially they are. You know, are you guys aware about all these things, international, when you meet representatives from UN?
Aware. I mean, everybody's. I mean, anybody who's following these things is acutely aware of the reality, and you know, we are going to fight these things in our own way. You know, Amnesty International uses international human rights law as a basis on which we challenge and hold governments accountable. We will keep doing that.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Salim.
Keep up the work. Yeah.